see something strange. Come with us and you will see. It's our town of Halloween. This is Halloween. This is Halloween. Pumpkins scream in the middle of night. This is Halloween. Everybody make a scene. Trick or treat.
Tell your neighbors on the drive.
It's our town. Everybody scream in this town of Halloween.
I am the one hiding under your bed. Teeth ground sharp.
Closer and welcome to Tales of Wales, the pod that never fails. Be a spooky little episode, all in time for All Hallows Eve. And my very own jack-o'-lantern is old King Cadge himself. what's the guy called from Nightmare Before Christmas?
Jack Skellington, baby.
Oh, my old Jack Skellington. And I'm your little dog. No, I'm that horrible
worm. What's this?
It's something in there. What's this? There's carling in the air. I'm like that horrible duck man who goes, ow! You know, he's always getting poisoned.
Oh, God, yeah.
Actually, I'd love to be Mr. Oogie Boogie. Oh, Mr. Oogie Boogie.
He's got all the bangers in that song. He's got an absolute baritone voice. I love it.
Yeah, no, he is one of the best. Well, that was an impromptu. Me and Jack always panic doing the intros, but I'm quite happy with how that turned out, because I just realised we could make this a Halloween episode.
Yeah, absolutely. Ready for Spooktober, mate, as I keep seeing people do. And really annoying because it doesn't
work.
Rhyme with October.
No, it doesn't
rhyme with October,
does it?
So stop saying it, yeah.
Yeah, I hate that. What are your views on Halloween?
You know, I've always been a fan of old Hallows Eve or Calan Gaeaf in
Calan
Welsh.
Calan Gaeaf, that's the Welsh version for it.
And that's All Hallows Eve. And yeah, I've always liked it. It was... I used to be a little bit of a pussware when I was a baby, right? And
do you want to explain what that means to the energy?
Sorry, I used to be. I'll do it in levels. I was a pussware when I was a baby. I was a pussy when I was a kid. I was slightly anxious when I was a young child. There you go. Three levels of understanding there. So much so. Oh, I wasn't even planning on revealing this, but I used to have really bad nightmares when I was a kid. Until my granddad, right? He gave me this. He was into all like American history, and he gave me an Indian arrowhead necklace, right? And it's made out of like it's like flint or something like that. You know, maybe not flint, but something anyway, a sharp rock. And he basically, apparently, in Native American culture, it was a bravery necklace, so it used to make you brave. So he gave me that, and then I stopped having nightmares. So I know, sweet old man,
sweet old man.
But also, apparently, it's all bullshit because it applies, even though I'm not Native American. I've got a single drop of Native American.
Well, you don't know.
Oh, mate, well, maybe. Yeah, go back far enough.
You strike me as the. I'd call you. What kind of names do they have? Like Sitting Bull,
a real Geronimo kind of guy.
Sitting Bull or Black Elk Speaks. You would be Drunk Oaf Dribbles. That's what your name.
Drinking Can. I was thinking. Yeah.
Drinking Can. Oh, very good. Yeah, I like that. Rotten Egg. No, that's nothing. I don't know why I said that.
Smelly fuck.
Rubbish idiot.
shit podcast is going on tangent. Yeah.
I'm a big fan of Halloween. Do you remember when we had like a birthday? Because my birthday's soon, isn't it? Penblwydd. My birthday's in like 2 weeks'
time.
It is. And because my dog's so fucking shit scared of everything, I usually go out. We always have like about a big bunch of us go down to Cardiff Devils, and we all watch the hockey, and we go out for a sesh afterwards. Yeah. But because of fireworks night, because I'm born on fireworks night, around there, there's loads of like.
You've always been
fireworks.
A revolutionary, mate. In the womb, you were thinking, "I gotta fucking disrupt the."
I was like Gitter Fork himself, but I always worry. So we're too worried about leaving her with the fireworks because she fucking hates them. So I'm going to go to Jack's house this week for my birthday, which is mad. We do too much together.
We don't do enough.
So my birthday at yours. But I do you remember that time when you came up to mine when I was younger with our friends? And my mum put on a Halloween night for my birthday, and we went for a walk up the forest by mine. And
We were terrified, I remember.
It was like maybe a 10 o'clock walk up the forest, and it's the first thing my dad's ever... Like, my dad is not someone who's ever shown any interest in my life. The one time he was made to do something, he had to walk us up the forest in the pitch black.
He's a big Halloween head, though. Big Halloween head. Like, do anything for Halloween.
I don't remember about any birthday party, but my mum was too scared. So remember she sent him... He walked up the woods with us, and he walked really far ahead, so he didn't have to stand by us. And then that car was in front of him, and it like shone, and he looked like an alien, and we had to walk up the woods.
Yeah, don't know if that was a silhouette, wouldn't
it? I bring you love.
Is that the love between a man and a woman, or the love of a man for a fine Cuban cigar?
I bring you love.
It's bringing love. Don't let it get away.
Break its legs.
Yeah, but it was fun. It was fun, I think, wasn't it?
I remember it being fun. I remember it with happiness as opposed to despair or anything like that.
Yeah, just dawned on me now that maybe that's bleak. Yeah, bobbing for apples.
Did we do the bobbing apples and stuff? Yeah, you know, we loved the classics back then. It was a good time.
I actually think I love this Halloween. We're going to watch, because Emma's so scared of horrors, her friends are going to come over. I always say her friends, that sounds bad. Our friends are going to come over. And we're going to watch Scary Movie 1 to 3. We're going to have a little scary movie.
Excellent.
Yeah, because she's too scared to watch horrors.
Scary Movie is genuinely, like, I remember thinking it was funny when I was like 13, then there's a huge gap, a dry spell, if you will, of watching scary movie films where I never watched them, and we watched them not that long ago, maybe like 2 years ago together, didn't we, with a few cats?
Yeah, I think so.
It was us and a few of the other boys, and my fuck me, the first one is actually really funny.
Yeah, so we're going to...
Give it a rewatch.
So yeah, we're going to do 1 to 3, and and we're also going to play some spooky games, because we do board game nights, but we're going to play one of those games on the PlayStation where you can play it together and you pick what way you go. You're like in a lodge. Do you know that game? It's like
what's that, Little Monsters or something?
No,
that's one you like to play. I'm sure you've seen
it. Yeah, no, that's good. Little Nightmares, but this is one where you can play like lots of different characters, and it's kind of like a telltale game where you say, like, okay, do I run this way or do I walk that way? And you can all play it. And
Until Dawn?
Yes, that's the one. So that's our little Halloween tip.
That's good. Give that a go.
Yeah. If you pause
the game, right? And it goes to like a character menu and you can see the guy. If you tilt their head down with one stick and tilt their eyes up with another stick, they look like really special. So that's good fun.
To any listeners who might not be gamers but have a console in the house for some reason, it's a fun one to play if you don't really play much games, because you don't really need to do anything mechanically.
No, you don't have to have any like sort of skill, a sleight of hand or anything like that, do you? It's just you just got to make decisions.
And you live out this horror, so we're going to do that, which will be quite fun. We got a bunch of records to do tonight, so should we stop this jibber-jabbering and get into the meat and potatoes? Do we have any reviews to read out?
I do. I've got one here. Not a review, but a comment, right? And this one was on the
Stop
Maxim
doing
Ledig.
This bullshit, you idiot.
this is a nice one. So this was on the Maxim Ledig episode. The what's his name? I can't think of his English name now. Max.
Max
Ledig. Mad Max Ledig. Magnus Maximus. So yeah, this was on the a comment actually, as opposed to a review on the Maxim Ledig episode. The Magnus Maximus, and. You need to know the context of this. So basically, if you haven't listened to that episode, we have David Iwan's Amor Heed as the intro and outro. So Jack Dunn 01 commented on that episode, and he said, "Recommended pod by a mate. Fucking brilliant. Sorry if I'm not allowed to swear. On my run, there's a bastard of a hill. Hit the hill just as Dav's blasted his classic at the end. Flew up it. Cheers, boys."
What a ledge.
Absolutely. Love you, Jack Dunn, mate. Well done.
Jack Dunn, what an absolute hero. Yeah.
Just running up that hill. Love it.
Yeah, just we are. This is what people always say about our podcast. It spurs them on for physical prowesses. That's what.
Yeah, and it's very much been an uphill struggle since series one. So
very
yeah,
good.
Very apt. Very good. Also, I love that. Fucking brilliant. Sorry if I'm not allowed to swear. yeah, I don't I care though. Like, that's how I feel. Yeah, that's how I feel.
It's kind of rule breaking listeners we have. That's the kind of game we got going. So yeah, so like we said, it's a bit of a spooky thing, which we just realised accidentally. Jack's going to take us on a little terrifying tale of a Welsh persuasion. So I'm going to throw over to you now, Kaj. Hit us with your best shot.
Yes.
Fire away!
Calan. Very good. you said that came in so high pitched and spooked to me, and actually spooked me a little bit. So well done on theme.
Can I just one tangent? There was one time when I was I grew up with my granddad. He lived in his house, and one time when he passed away, we used to use his back room as a beer room. So all the boys used to come over and stay in our house.
I remember fondly.
So everyone loved the beer room. It was like one of it was a big part of our childhood, and which sounds bleak. one time, my friend was down in the beer room, and I was cooking his bacon for like a hangover breakfast. And I can't sing, but I sung "We'll meet again." I don't know when. I don't know where. And I hit the notes like beautifully. And it was so bizarre. And my friend came out. He walked up. And he went. Was that you singing? I was like, the ghost of that song took over my body, and I've never been able to recreate it ever since. But maybe instead of having you listen to me, we'll drop in the actual song when I sung then, because I might kill myself if I ever hear that back.
Yeah, couldn't tell the difference, mate. Couldn't tell the difference. Anyway, right. So yes, today we've got a little spooky tale. One of a spooky tale. It's from Welsh folklore, Welsh mythology, which is very in keeping with Calan Gaeaf or Halloween. And this story is called "The Demon of Cerrigydrudion." That's a hell of a mouthful. I'm going to try and practice that a little bit more. Cerrigydrudion. There we go. Let me make sure I say that right now for the rest of it. But yeah, the Demon of Cerrigydrudion. And this is one, me and Frank's been trying a little bit for a new thing lately, where we're trying to, especially with mythological stuff, instead of just sort of reciting what someone else has done, we're trying to like write them ourselves a bit, aren't we? I may be explaining that wrong, but sort of take the essence of it and just, sort of run with it ourselves a little bit, add our own little flair. So I've tried to do that.
Like we said before, when I did it for the Pwyll episode, where it was that story from the Mabinogion, the whole point of these are tales you're meant to tell and keep telling and keep retelling. There isn't like one set in stone. So we thought, well, why not we do our own spin on it? And yeah, like we said, there aren't no right ways or wrong ways to tell it. So
And certainly back in the day, these were told like almost, not Chinese whispers, but they're told from generation to generation, and they would have had their own retellings and stuff like that. So yeah, we thought we'd adopt that, make it a bit more authentic. So I've tried that on this one. Hopefully it'll be decent and not dog shit, but here we go. So it was a cold winter's night long ago in Cerrigydrudion.
Oh, can we drop in? Can we drop in?
Go on.
Like barn doors slamming and
Yeah, we do proper sound effects. We make this a proper like a proper story. The night was so silent that most of the townsfolk awoke when the quiet was pierced by an almighty banging coming from the village church. A farmer living across from the church peered out of his window to see its large oak doors smashed through and nothing but an eerily pale face floating in the doorway. The town gathered in dismay and slowly approached the church, their priest leading the way. As the village drew closer, the sallow face grew more ghastly, its eyes gazing upon them, shining in the moonlight like shimmering rubies, its large body still obscured in the shadow of the night. "Who are you? What do you want?" cried the priest nervously. I'm a demon and I want to eat, growled the face, revealing its forked tongue and beastly teeth as it spoke. The villagers grew fearful, but the pious priest stepped forward. You're no demon, he said. God would not allow such devilry in my church. As soon as the holy man's sentence had ended, he was snatched from where he stood and flung through the darkened doorway of the church as if by some infernal magic. The only sounds that could be heard were that of his screams, for a wet, pulpy tearing turned them to silence. The pale face appeared once more, this time spattered with blood, the red appearing almost black in the moonlight. The villagers were stunned in fear as the devil spoke again. Each night you will feed me, or each night I shall feed on you, it hissed. And with those words, the church doors slammed shut. From then on, every night, the terrified villagers would leave an offering for the demon, hoping it would be enough to save them from the same fate as the priest. Each night, the devil would chastise the villagers, demanding more for the next offering, and night after night, the villagers would oblige. Before long, the villagers' crops had been picked bare and the livestock slaughtered. The last of their food was given to the demon, and once again, he demanded more. But before the doors of the church could shut, a brave villager spoke up. We have no more food to give, demon. What would you have us do? If you will not offer me food, I shall feast on the children of your village, starting with the youngest. Bring the babe to me tomorrow night, demanded the demon. The villagers were distraught at the thought of sacrificing their own children to the devil in the church. With time of the essence and enough desperation to cast their judgments aside, a brave few went to seek the advice of an old witch who lived on the hill just outside the village. The witch went by the name Cunhull. When they arrived, it was as if the witch already knew why they had come. I know you seek the means to chain the devil and pull him from these lands, said the old crone, wizened and shabby. I'll tell you how, but you must do three things for me in return. The villagers would surely do anything to see this demon ousted from their home, and eagerly asked the witch what she wanted of them. Firstly, she croaked, once it is done, you shall refer to me as the wise woman of Cerrigydrudion. You will no longer refer to me as witch. The villagers agreed. Secondly, she continued, you will no longer burn my covenly sisters and those like me at the stake. There was a time the villagers would have hesitated at such a demand, but that time was long gone. They agreed once more. And thirdly, she began, once the church is clear, you will build a tavern and all will be welcome within it. The villagers agreed for the third time, and so the wise woman of Cerrigydrudion shared her knowledge.
She's that kind of witch, making everyone make a pun.
Yeah, absolutely. Mate, this is what clued me into the story. When I saw that bit, I was like, oh yes, she's a boozer like us boys. Yeah.
Just don't call me a witch.
Just don't call me a goddamn witch. So we was like, yeah. First, you'll need to tempt the beast from the church, she said. You'll need to find the most beautiful woman in your village to coax this devil, and Aira Wynn is the perfect girl for the job. Once he's outside, you'll need to bind him with the sturdiest chains your blacksmith can forge, cooled in holy water. Once he's bound, no man will have the strength to carry him away. Seek the great twin oxes that graze on the moor, the Dai Achain Banaug. Only they have the strength to heave the demon from this place. The villagers set to work right away. The blacksmith and his apprentices forged the biggest, strongest chains they'd ever seen, cooled in holy water just as Cunhull had told them. The woodsmen of the village felled the largest tree surrounding the village and with them constructed a giant sled for the Dai Achain Banaug to pull the devil with. The best huntsmen searched for the great oxes on the Banaug moors and drew the Dai Achain Banaug back to the village. The seamstresses sewed the most seductive dress for Aira Wynn, making sure it would catch the demon's eye, while others bathed her and brushed her hair with the finest smelling oils. All was set as night drew in, and even Cunhull came down from a hill to watch events unfold. As it neared the offering time and the church doors swung open, Aira, scantily clad in her new attire, approached the doorway, but stopped as if she was tending the flowers a few yards before the entrance. The demon, a creature of primal vice, could not refuse such beauty and lunged from the holy house at the fair maiden. The creature was large and pale like a dead giant devoid of blood, its sharp claws lunging for Aira, its crimson eyes fixed only on her. Before the devil could strike, the largest men of the village flung the giant holy chains around the beast and pulled them tight. The chains hissed as they touched the beast's skin. You cannot take me from this place, hissed the demon, and I will break free from these chains soon enough. The huntsman brought forth a giant oxen, and while the devilish creature flailed and screeched, the villagers hitched him to the Dai Achain Banaug, who strained enough to pull the demon onto the sled. Once he was secure, they chained the sled to the mighty oxen, and they slowly but surely pulled him from the village. The villagers cheered as the devil left their hometown, but as they watched, they saw the Dai Achain Banaug continue to pull the screaming devil further and further, eventually reaching a great lake. The two ox, knowing the magic of the world, knew the lake as a gateway to the netherworld, Anun, and so pulled the devil on his sled into the water, deeper and deeper, until both the demon and the Dai Achain Banaug were submerged. The demon of Cerrigydrudion was never seen again, along with the brave ox that took him from the world. The village named the lake Llyn y Ddau Achain, the lake of the two oxen. Today you can still see the ruts made by the sled as it took the demon to his watery end. There we are, that's all that, basically. I kind of went through that quite quick, but...
So I'm going to do some episodes about Welsh folklore as well, and Anwen, the other world, or it's like the demon world or spirit world.
It's like, yeah, it's like spirit world, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, and so those are things you said in there. I cover in, I have similar stuff in one of my episodes. I didn't realise oxen were such a big part of Welsh folklore. The ox come back into it a lot.
I'd never heard of these big bad oxen boys.
Yeah. Wait,
also another little tangent I saw in it, I read about in this, is that because Eirawen, the sort of the buxom girl that tempted the devil, that's Snow White in English.
Yeah.
I couldn't find any like thing of like actual tangent to the Brothers Grimm tale.
Yeah.
But I thought that was just interesting nonetheless.
Yeah. So Ada Wynn, Snow White, hot, an absolute certified babe.
Yeah, basically. She's too hot, so hot a babe that fucking devil boy in the church was like, I gotta have a piece of this.
I gotta have a go.
Left the safety of the church. I gotta have a go, bro.
I definitely gotta have a go. Actually, lush. She absolutely lush. When you described it as like a pale, big thing, I thought, oh, you're slamming us here.
Yeah, a pale, big, schlubby mess. Got a can of bow in his hand.
Yeah, idiot, stupid. Well, that was our spooky tale for All Hallows.
I hope it wasn't too spooky for you. Yeah.
But we're going to do a little mini series of Welsh folklore for the next few episodes.
We've actually, because although this one will coincide with Spooktober, I hate it, October 29th, Spocktober? Whatever, no. October 31st even, sorry. Yeah.
Don't even know the date.
I know. I put up my calendar on my computer and the first thing I saw was 29. It must be 29. Anyway. So this one will coincide with Spooktober. But the next, I think we got 3, 4, I'm not sure anymore. But we've got a few episodes. But they think of them as a series to do with Halloween mythology, spooky stuff.
Yeah, we're covering like oral tradition or oral history for the next few episodes. And if you don't like that, you can fucking shove it up your ass, because that's what we're doing.
Clip of Austin Powers going, oral, baby, in there as well at some point.
Bye, love.
Don't forget, Mr. Powers, later you have a brief oral exam.
Well, I hope it's mostly oral and not too brief. Baby, you know, breathing or exam.
Right. Well, should we wrap up this episode as a quick, a smaller episode than usual? But this is just our brief Halloween special.
Yeah, it's got a demon in it, so that's how it's Halloween, all right?
Yeah, you stupid idiots.
To say as well, yeah, give us the 5-star reviews and shit like that. Let us know what you think of the pod, blah, blah, blah. We've got a little donation link in the description if you fancy helping out with fees and shit like that and supporting our little awesome pod, my lord. Yeah. Then you can help out that way.
Yeah, and we'd be ever so grateful. And if you can't spare any shekels, just send it on to your mates, like our old Jack Dunn's best mate did for him. So we'd be ever so grateful.
Exactly.
So, Diolchum Grandach, give us a reviews. We love you loads. Keep up, keep being you. And don't be too spooked out by Spooktober. Yeah,
don't scare yourself too much by listening to this episode.
We did the mash.
We did the mash.
We'll meet again. Don't know where. Don't know when. But I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. So will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again, don't know where. Don't know what.